What's up, YouTubers? My name is Eli Horak, and I want to talk to you about something that is called history that transcends. And I know that we live in a social world that we talk about Justin Bieber every day, Hannah Montana, which of course is Miley Cyrus, or Selena Gomez. But hey, once for one day, I'm going to be talking about Richard Evans Bubble. There's no time. Guys, in 1904, in the beautiful Mountain View of Arkansas, there was a great American family. They had a kid named Richard Edwin Powell. Little did they know that his kid was going to become a great hit singer. He started out singing for 10 cents in local train stations, different denomination of churches. He became the first vocalist as an adult in the orchestra in a hotel in Kentucky, Louisville, and then was in a local radio station called WHAS. And the fame and how the fans loved his singing was growing more than ever. Between us, what happened here was that he actually desired to have his own family also, like how he grew up with. But his commitment to doing music was so tense. It was even tense like the same way that Justin Bieber had his big hit on YouTube, that sadly his first matrimony with Mildred Mudd, with his voice, and actually guys, go check his voice. It was amazing. He was also offered to be in a theater in Ohio, Indianapolis, where he also saw a lot of the future stars for Hollywood like Jean Harlow and Ginger Rogers. And finally, the chance of his life. He got a big deal for the Warner Brothers on the hit musical of his time, 42nd Street, in 1933. Guys, if it wasn't for 42nd Street, High School Musical from Disney nowadays wouldn't be around. Not trying to get mad at the High School Musical fans, but come on guys, let's think about it. Warner Brothers was actually not the first studio they had a talking picture thing, but the first studio they had a success of a talking picture with the movie The Jazz Singer in 1927 from Elle Johnson. So basically, why High School Musical in this world? Because if it wasn't for their success, we wouldn't see the musicals that we like to sing nowadays. And going back for what we're talking about, Warner Bros. Was looking for somebody young, tenor voice, unique, charming, that would just capture people to go to the movies every week. Because the thing here was that there was no Instagram, no Facebook, no social media, so people needed to live. Come on, people. So actually, Dick Powell just fit in the shoe for that thing that Warner Bros. Was looking for. And then they had the beautiful, also talented Ruby Keeler in 42nd Street, the wife of Elle Johnson, which when that movie came out, it was a big success between Dick Powell and Ruby Keeler. And also they made 6 more movies together and an all-time favorite legend music that you guys have heard in Glee in different places called I Only Have Eyes For You. Let's check it out right now. My love must be the kind of blind love. I can't see anyone but you. And dear, I wonder if you'll find love, an optical illusion too. Are the stars out tonight? I don't know if it's cloudy or bright, 'cause I only have eyes for you, dear. The moon may be high, but I can't see a thing in the sky, 'cause I only have eyes for you. I don't know if we're in a garden or on a crowded avenue. You are here, so am I. Maybe millions of people go by, but they all disappear from you. And I only have eyes for you. So after the great hit of 42nd Street comes Gold Diggers in 1933, where Dick Powell met his second love of his life, John Wonder. was a great idea to team him up to be the next big couple from the day. There was, you know, Ginger Rogers, there are different couples. Just so they're like, let's put John Bondo with Dick Powell. And sadly, the audience of 42nd Street was not the same in the 1936. So, sadly, it was not a success. And years later, the couple. So later years, after Dick Powell leave the Warner Brothers to basically be more serious on roles that are about detectives and being the hero, he met his third love of his life, and actually, I guess his real love of his life, June Allison from the MGM. She was new in the MGM, she was only 18, and they had a son together, of course, years later after they got married, with Dick Powell called Richard Edwin Jr. Oh, and for those that are asking why the change of the name, well, actually, the real name of Dick Powell was Richard Edwin Powell. But the Warner Brothers thought that Dick Powell was a better name or artistic. So the matrimony actually lasted until his passing day. Sadly, Dick Powell decides to go to the doctor and discovers that he has cancer in the throat. And it's funny for his friends, like they said, because their friend saw him and saw him well. He actually made jokes about it, like, somebody needs to unspell the word cancer. He was very optimistic. He already started in the late 50s, like 57 to the 60s. His company of television called Four Stars, where he was actually helping youngsters on the television to become great writers and stuff like that. Which one of them was actually Aaron Spelling from the hit show Charlie's Angel, of course, decades later. So he had a bright future, a lot of great ideas for the television, but sadly in January 2 of 1963, he lost his battle with cancer, passing away. But the seed that he left for the writers of this new generation was very amazing. He was a fundamental artist, he had a successful career, he had a voice supernatural, and he loved helping other people. And of course, he was the pioneer of the musicals in the 30s. Richard Edwin Powell will be always remembered by something that he left, because believe it or not, a lot of the musicals that we see nowadays are copy and paste from the early 30 movies. If not, check it yourself. So I think his history will transcend a lot of generations to come.